Right, it's time to do something with CDs or CD-ROMs. I recently got this beautiful Sega Mega CD 2. I was looking for a Mega CD for years and I've always wanted one, and now finally I have one. But that made me kind of think about the audio in old games, and especially CD audio, how it worked and how it is different from modern optical drives and computers. Back then it was very popular to put Redbook audio, or just basically audio CD tracks, on a game like this, for instance, NBA Jam, or Echo the Dolphin, which has absolutely beautiful music. But one of the great multimedia features of CD-ROM drives, and one of the big promises of them, was that you could also play your regular music CDs like this one from Technotronic or many others. Yeah, I just picked Technotronic because I thought it was kind of fitting for the era that the Mega CD came out, and the fact that the music of Streets of Rage is kind of inspired by it. But the thing is, in the mid-90s, CD-ROM drives started to become popular. And well, the fact that you could play audio CDs was really nice. But did you know that the sound card really had nothing to do with the CD playback? It was all kind of self-contained. Unlike modern computers, where the optical drive is really just a drive with a data interface and all the audio decoding is done in software and then processed by the sound card. But back then it was really different. As you might know, the Mega CD contains a 8-channel PCM chip from Ricoh, which is quite nice and really gives the Mega CD its enhanced sound effects, but it is not responsible for the CD playback. That is actually done by a second chip, one that is just a common chip that you find in any sort of CD player of the era. Same thing with the Amiga CD32. The Paula chip is really just a very simple basic 4-channel PCM chip, which only has an 8-bit resolution. It just cannot really play audio CDs in the quality of an audio CD. So what did they do? They just used a very common CD player chip, and it works completely separately and independently of the rest of the audio system. And that's what I'm going to demonstrate with a couple of old CD-ROM drives. So I've got a setup here. I've got a stack of old CD drives of various types, including one that is modern. And then I have here a power supply and a speaker. And one thing to make this stuff work is, I bridged this power supply here. Connected the green wire to the black wire. There are some pinouts you can find on the internet on how to do this. But basically, if I connect the power, this thing will turn on. And here are the drives. I've got a kind of old CD-ROM drive that has a headphone output, a volume control, but no play button. And then I have one here that comes originally from my old Pentium 2. Before it got the Plex Store burner. This one has the play button. This is a DVD-ROM drive with a play button. And this is a modern DVD drive with a SATA interface. And then we've got a very nice collection of music here. Although, I won't be using any of those in the demonstration because of YouTube audio reasons. A complete random selection of music here. Just stuff that I find interesting for various reasons. This is Fire from Inner City. Really nice album. It's the successor to the Paradise album with Good Life. Has some Streets of Rage-like music on it. Same for Technotronic. Then we've got something a little bit darker. This is a Soft Cell. It's completely different. Love Me Some James Brown. And of course, talking about funk and jazz and soul, this is Incognito's Jazz Funk album. Then, completely different territory, this is Clan of Xymox. This is gothic music. Some progressive rock from the Alan Parsons Project. Absolutely great album. Then we have some grungy rock music from the mid-90s. Nirvana's Nevermind. Gotta love some Nirvana. Then we got some synth pop. This is Human League. Pretty good album, in my opinion. Then we've got some really audiophile great stuff. This is Aja from Steely Dan. Absolutely fantastic album, in my opinion. Not a great one. This is the seventh one from Toto. And now my all-time favorite from when I was a child, Invisible Touch from Genesis, one of the first albums I've ever heard. My dad had a cassette of this and I listened to this whilst playing with Legos when I was 6 years old. Yeah, it was the cassette version. But yeah, this album is engraved in my brain since my early childhood. It's one of my all-time favorites. But I won't be using any of those because of, well, YouTube copyright reasons, but I have something different here. And this here is a collection of some music from a concert that I actually played in many years ago. Yeah, this is what it is. Einduitvoering projectweek 10 maart 2000 door de slagwerkleerlingen van Volkert Buis en Raymond Ruitenberg. In the late 90s, early 2000s, I played drums at local music school of Hengelo. Volkert Buis was the teacher. And yeah, every year there was kind of like a project and there was some kind of concert that we had to do. And yeah, that concert got recorded on this CDR, which is now almost 20 years old because, well, it's December 2019 as I'm recording this. So yeah, this is an almost 20-year-old CDR. Yesterday I made a backup copy of this, just to be sure. There's one track that I am featured in, it's number 8, Batteries. I'm one of the many snare drum players on that track. So this is the CD I'm going to be using, mainly to avoid YouTube copyright reasons. So first some basics. This is a drive that has a open and close button, a volume button, a headphone out and a volume control. And then if you take a look at the back, we can see the power interface, the IDE data interface, the master slave selection, and this is the analog audio section. And this here is digital, and those jumpers here, I'm not sure what they are for. But yeah, this is just an typical example of an old-fashioned drive, even though this is a DVD one and not a CD one. The same principles apply to older CD drives. The audio that you have here is just an analog line level that goes to the sound card, and it isn't processed by the sound card's deck, it just goes to the mixing. So the sound card is really just summing two analog sources together, and the digital audio probably bypasses the drive's internal deck and may use the sound card's deck. I'm not entirely sure of that. But then we've got this more modern drive. As you can see, this modern drive only has an open and close button and none of the other things. It doesn't have the volume dial, it doesn't have the play button, and it only has this SATA interface. So this is really just a storage drive. It works completely different. This one depends on software processing. Modern operating systems like Windows, they just read the CD just as a raw data stream. They just read the linear PCM audio as a raw stream, and then the software decodes it, processes it, and it is output through the deck of the sound card. So that's quite different. This is dependent on the sound card, whereas this can work completely standalone. So let's just connect it up. I'm going to connect the power to this one. And now we can just use this cable over here.
Power on.
I'm really just using this really cheap Bluetooth speaker that my colleague Patrick once gave to me. I normally use it with the Pentium 2 computer. But yeah, for this demonstration I'll be using this, and the audio is basically just the ambient room audio that comes from this speaker. Yeah, it's an old drive, it doesn't directly cooperate. That's what you get with old tech. Yesterday it worked fine. So, now it wants to cooperate. So, let's press play. And you can hear the concert being played. And of course I can easily skip tracks. The backup copy. I don't know what track this is, but there are some really interesting bits on there. Oh yeah, I think we're now playing track number 6, the marimba phase. And then track number 7 should be Carousel. Oh, I must say the pot meter on this volume dial is not working properly anymore. But as you can hear, it works completely independently, no sound card required, it can just function completely on its own. And now track number 8. This track over here. I'm one of the snare drum players in this track. But what about the other drive? Will it work for this one? It doesn't have a start-stop button. This other drive that I've got here at the bottom should be capable too, but sadly it doesn't have a button to actually start the playback. So yeah, I just can't start playback, even though it has the volume dial, you won't hear anything because it will just not start playing. This one requires the computer to give it a command to start playing, because that is possible through the IDE interface. It is software controllable. The computer can tell the drive to start and stop playing. Even though this one should still have the deck, as far as I'm aware, it just doesn't have this actual start button. But yeah, a cool feature of those older drives was that you could just play audio CDs without even really needing a sound card. Because you could just simply plug in the headphone and press play, and presto, you could listen to some music. It was really neat. And sadly, that just isn't possible with one of those modern SATA drives. They always depend on a sound card and software to play the music. Here are the basics of how the old school CD-ROM drive worked. First you have the standalone drive with the CD that has the Redbook audio, then the drive has its own audio CD decoding circuitry and a DAC. That audio can go straight out to the headphone, or it can go with a line-out cable into the sound card's analog mix input, and then there is output over the speaker, and the application on a computer is really just a dummy thing. It just gives some commands to the CD drive over the IDE interface to start or stop play certain tracks. So it's kind of crude, and this is a fully self-contained system. The sound card doesn't really have much to do with the actual DAC. But now the modern solution. In the modern solution, we've got a drive that's really just a data drive with a SATA interface, and the software is actually a lot more involved in this case. In the modern solution, the software just reads the data, the raw PCM data that comes from the CD, then decodes it, and then sends that decoded data to the DAC of the sound card, and the DAC then outputs it over the speakers or the headphones. So those are the two basic principles. So now let's take a look at the back of the Mega CD. Of course, as you all know, the Mega Drive 1 has this headphone output. In the case of the Mega CD, you also need that cable in order to route the audio, because as you can see, there's quite a lot of stuff going on. These two cables here are your left and right audio that go to your stereo system, and this one is actually the cable that goes from the Mega Drive's headphone output. So that's how you can get the sound from the CD and the Mega Drive's output to be mixed together. The chip that's responsible for the CD playback in the Sega Mega CD could actually be this chip from Sanyo, the LC7883K. According to this datasheet, it's a digital to analog converter, and I found this on a website about the Sega Mega CD hardware. Here's a list of all the chips that's inside the Mega CD. And you can find it on this URL, console5.com/wiki/SegaCD2V2Sony. Apparently the Mega CDs were made by both Sony and Funai, depending on the model. And yeah, you can even see some schematics and service manuals here. Let's see if we can open up the PDF. This is the service manual for the Mega CD. I think this is for the first model, but this should give a kind of an overview of all the chips that's in there. And maybe we can find out about that particular Sanyo chip. Oh, that's even it even includes the Mega Drive's own components. PCM sound source, this should be the Rico chip. Apparently it's a slightly modified chip. It's very similar to a chip that they used in the Sega System 18 and System 32 arcade board. Let's see, battery backup, dynamic RAM. I don't know what that is. CD-ROM LSI. Some op amp, yeah, one of those chips in there should be the chip that handles the CD audio. Here is the service manual of the Amiga CD32, and this has some information, a diagram and such, and also a part list of all the chips that they used. Let's look at the diagram, because there is a diagram of it. Yes, this is the system block diagram. You see, here is the Paula chip that goes to the audio output, and this is the CD deck, also goes to the audio output. So they are two separate things. And if you browse a bit further and we look at the parts that they used, should also be a Sanyo chip. Let's see, where was it? This one. IC DEC Audio LC788335M. Very similar to that chip that Sega used in the Mega CD. I think that's quite noteworthy. So there you have it, that was quite a fascinating journey into old computer CD-ROM drives and Redbook audio. I hope you enjoyed it, and thanks for watching.